Hey folks, Marco here. This is ComfyUI Crash Course Part 2. Requirements are mostly the same as in the previous video. I have added two more, but these are entirely optional and I only use it for a brief demo. I recommend you watch the video first before deciding whether to install it. And just very briefly, I want to thank Zach for buying me my first coffee and my one Patreon supporter for backing me financially. When you purchase YouTube Premium and then watch someone's video, it turns out that Google does not pass it on to the creator if their channel is small like mine. You need to have this many subscribers and this many watch hours. With that said, to anyone who watches this video until the end, thank you, your time is valued and appreciated. And on that note, let's jump in. All right, so as before, I will open Automatic 1111 and then my ComfyUI is going to be on the other tab. The workflow from previous video, our very first workflow, is now available on Civitai. You can just download it from the attachments. So you download the zip, extract the archive, and inside there will be a PNG file showing the workflow I have. Now, of course, we're not entering all this information manually. One of the cool things you can do in ComfyUI is simply load the workflow by doing a drag and drop like this. Now, first thing I want to talk about is the way workflows in ComfyUI get executed, because it does not work the way you might think. Let me show you what I mean. All these nodes that are not inside of any groups, I'm going to bring them here and then I'm going to select them all and mute them, Control M. Now, if I execute the code, Control Enter, error says prompt has no outputs. So you see, ComfyUI doesn't start by loading your checkpoint, processing all this information, then getting up to, say, this point here, then realize, oh, wait, there's nothing here, so I will stop. It doesn't work left to right. It actually operates recursively. You see, preview image, save image, SEGS preview, preview bridge, all these nodes are classed as output nodes. And what that means is that somewhere in their code, there is a parameter called output node that has the value set to true. So ComfyUI begins by first searching for these output nodes in the workflow and then recursively figuring out a path to get to them. So for example, if I unmute this node here, we expect workflow to flow all of the way up to this node here and then stop. It does not progress beyond this point. In fact, I'm going to press Control Enter. And as you can see, the generation stops here. Why is this important? Well, imagine that I'm just going to delete this image and I'm just going to drag this and click preview image. Suppose you wanted workflow to stop somewhere here for whatever reason. So you decide, okay, I'm going to mute this node and I'm going to maybe mute basic pipe. So that should stop the workflow and no problems, right? But then when you hit execute, you suddenly get an error and you think, wait, something's wrong here. I didn't connect this. And then you're trying to figure out what went wrong without realizing that this guy is the culprit. If you want the execution to stop, this preview image needs to be muted. But you wouldn't know this from the error because there's a big red circle here telling you something's wrong with the sampler. And then you're like, what is going on? As the developer RG3 has put it on his GitHub page, when a workflow is processed, it first moves backwards, starting at each output node, preview image, save image, even display string, and then works backwards to all possible paths to get there. So when you first start using ComfyUI, this is one of those common mistakes that you will make, that one of those things that will trick you. It certainly caught me a number of times until I figured out what is going on. The other thing I wanted to discuss today is I want to clarify a couple of things about inpainting. As you know, in Automatic 1111, when you do inpainting, you have four options: fill, original, latent noise, and latent nothing. So if you apply a mask, I'm just going to quickly put a mask here, and if I put denoising strength to 0, then that will kind of give us a hint of what actually reaches stable diffusion model. So if I run this as it currently is, you can see that the plate is still there. However, if I choose latent nothing and then run the workflow, you can see that we just got a blob here, right? So I guess, in other words, the model, stable diffusion model, doesn't actually see what is behind the mask. It doesn't know what is there. And that is kind of what we have done here. You see, if I do the same thing, in fact, if I set this, I think it has to be a little bit above 0, and unmute this node here. And now if I run the workflow, you can see that there's a bit of a gray patch here. Now, if you're thinking, well, whatever, gray blob in, gray blob out, this is actually not gray. See, if I change the color, then it'll perhaps be easier to see. If I make this node red and then I make this node red, can you see that this is actually a transparency bit there? In fact, if I were to drag this here and then do a preview image, you will see that the plate is still there. But when you do VAE encode for in painting, that information, what was underneath the mask, gets destroyed. In fact, it gets painted by this gray color. That is because Stable Diffusion ink painting models have been trained to fill these. The original intent was reparation of old damaged photographs. So in automatic 1111, if you're looking for fill or latent nothing, the closest thing to those settings is to use this node here, at least as far as I'm aware. But what if you want original? What if you want the Stable Diffusion to know that there is a plate underneath that? This is often used when you don't want to replace the object, but rather you want just to tweak it a little bit to improve it or get a variation of it. So in ComfyUI, to do that, we use node called set latent noise mask. So for example, if I take this input image and then instead of VAE encode for in paint, I will choose the one above. And then what I will do is I will use the mask from here. And of course we need VAE to encode pixels into latent. Now let's duplicate all three of these. So the sampler, VAE encode and preview image, Control C, Control V, connect latent, get the pipe. Now if I run, see that the plate is still there. So I would typically use VAE encode for in painting to use the out painting as we have seen, or when I want to remove something. Now, what about in paint masked only? Here under in paint area, you have whole picture and only masked. As you know, when you choose whole picture, your prompt should be describing the whole picture overall. When you put only mask, then typically you should be describing specifically what is there. Well, we've kind of already done that when we did detailing. So detailing is, in a sense, in paint masked only, because if you recall, we have used a mask to SEGS and then set the crop factor in a way that focuses in on the part of the image. Let me run this whole workflow. So if I unmute this one, we have set crop factor to 1.5 from the default value, which I believe was 3. So by setting it to 1.5, that zooms in on the mask. So now the only thing I need to describe is what is in this cropped area. And I'm doing that here. Remember, that is why I replaced the prompt with cat sitting on kitchen bench. Because AI at this point does not see anything beyond the edges of the crop region. All right, next, let me just quickly tidy up the workflow. Now, if you recall, the very first image we have generated was this one, right? Now, what happens if you take the prompt that we have used in automatic 1111? I can just paste the prompt here. Sampler was DPM plus plus 2M. Scheduler was normal. Width of the image was 288. And CFG was 8. And of course, we need to fix the seed. The seed we have used was 6. So now, if I hit generate, I got an image that is quite different. Despite all the parameters down to the checkpoint and everything else is the same, the output is still different. The reason for this is the manner in which noise gets generated. To quote Dr. Lieutenant Dada, ComfyUI uses CPU for generating random noise, while Automatic 1111 uses GPU. And so if I go to settings under Stable Diffusion, you can see random number generator source. By default, Automatic 1111 uses GPU, whereas ComfyUI by default uses CPU. So if I switch to CPU, click apply, and then generate, I get the same image. Now, unfortunately, there are further differences than that. It's also how the weights are interpreted. For example, if I click on the word Italian and then hold down Control and press up arrow key, as you know, this puts more emphasis on the word. Pressing down arrow decreases the emphasis. And as you can see, this happens in increments of 0.1. 1, 2, 3. You can do the same thing in ComfyUI in exactly the same way. Click 1, 2, 3. You'll notice that increments are 0.05, and there is a reason for that. You see, automatic 11-11 normalizes the weights you place across. This is what lets you get away with some really high weights, like 1.6 even, or 1.5, 1.7, because they all get normalized and spread across. ComfyUI, on the other hand, doesn't do the normalization for you. So lower weights can have stronger impact. So in stable diffusion, if we go to settings, and let's say I tap the word normalize, you can see there's this setting called emphasis mode. By default, automatic 11-11 has the setting set as original. The original emphasis implementation. So in other words, yes, we will normalize your weights. ComfyUI has no normalization. Personally, if you ask me, I probably wouldn't change any of these settings. In fact, I will change back the setting I have changed earlier, this one here. So now if I generate, I will go back to that image. Instead of getting automatic 11-11 to emulate ComfyUI, it is far easier to change ComfyUI to behave as automatic 11-11. There are, in fact, custom nodes you can get specifically for this. For example, in Inspire Pack, those are custom nodes made by the developer of the node manager. So it is this third one from the list. So what I will do is I will double click and I will type ksampler pipe, and then choose this third one here, the one that says automatic 11-11 compatibility. Oh, by the way, that is also the path where the node is located. So if you are manually searching for it, that tells you that you need to click on Inspire Pack, automatic 11-11 compat, and then here it is. Now, let me quickly enter those same parameters. So the seed was 6. I will set this to fixed. Sampler was DPM plus plus 2M. And now, noise mode, I will set to GPU. Let's get the latent and connect these quickly just to see what we get. And here we go. It is the same image as here. If you don't get the same image, make sure that seed is 6, and also make sure that you have removed the weight that we have placed earlier in the demo. So I've removed the emphasis on the word Italian. And if you find yourself in a situation that you have to apply weights, or rather put emphasis on words here, as Dr. Rada says, ComfyUI and automatic 11-11 have different interpretations of weighting. To align them, you need to use advanced clip text encode, which is a node from Blender Echo. So once you install it, this node will be located under conditioning advanced. Unless you're using SDXL, it will be the first one here. And this lets you choose whether or not you want normalization. So this is the default for Comfy, but if you're trying to reproduce someone's results from automatic 11-11, you would probably need to set this to automatic 11-11 as the weight interpretation, and normalization will probably be one of these. You'd have to experiment. Personally, I don't use these compatibility nodes, but if you are transitioning from automatic 11-11, you might find them handy. And lastly, to wrap up for today, I'm going to unmute this last node and just run the whole workflow again. Now let's add another bounding box detector, BBOX. So yes, we are going to discuss SEGS further. Why? Because YOLO. So YOLO is something you have seen in automatic 11-11 as well as ComfyUI. For example, you see that the names of models are Face YOLO 8M, Hand YOLO 8S, and so on. In fact, if I go to automatic 11-11, I have off-screen installed a detailer extension. I'm sure you would have used and heard of it. So perhaps you've seen all this YOLO, 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 and then you wondered, what is that? These are object detection models developed by Ultralytics. Object detection is a task that involves identifying the location and class of object in an image. And we have seen how that works in ComfyUI. Output of object detector is a set of bounding boxes that enclose object in the image. So I'll just do another preview here. And now if I run, it detected a face. So this bit is the bounding box. And obviously I won't do it, but the same thing happens in automatic 11-11. But maybe you look at these and you didn't know, wait, what are these? What does N mean? What does S mean? Like, which one should you choose? So YOLO stands for you only look once. And these Letters refer to the size of a model. Is it nano, small, medium, large, or extra large? So now if I go back to ComfyUI, and if I select a general model, then I can, for example, type the word person here. And then when I run it, it detects the person. If I type the word cat, it detects the cat. If I type pizza, it'll detect pizza. Now, before you get too excited, I must admit I am cheating, because these models are pre-trained on COCO dataset. So that means that there is only really 80 classes of objects. And as it so happens, cat, person, and pizza happens to be on that list of 80. So I am kind of cheating. The fact that we have generated an image that has a cat, pizza, and a person is not an accident. So I'll just change this back to all. So when we use detailer, these models that we pick, like face, hand, person, these models have been fine-tuned for that purpose. In fact, Ultralytics website has very extensive documentation on how to do just that. They have FAQ as well. How do I train a custom object detection model using Ultralytics, and so on. So YOLO models that we are using are typically fine-tuned. So now you know what these parameters do. For example, when you're detecting faces, threshold decides what constitutes a face, because output of object detection model isn't just a bounding box. It also gives you the confidence interval. For example, 92% confident that this is a person, 83% confident that this is a traffic cone, and so on. So if you were to go to web UI, and for example, if you were to set threshold to a given value, let's say 0.95, then only one object will be detected. With a bar that high, this object is the only one that is sufficiently a traffic cone. And of course, if we increase this to 1, then you won't get any output. At that point, your object detection model becomes Plato. What is a traffic cone marker? Can anything truly be a traffic cone? All traffic cones in the physical world are merely imperfect representations or shadows of ideal traffic cone that exists in the realm of ideas, and I'll stop bullshitting now. We will end it here. Thank you for watching. For more videos on traffic cones, make sure to like and subscribe. Until then, class dismissed.